Surah 2, 190. Allah does not love those who exceed the limits. Surah 2, 276. Allah does not love any ungrateful sinner. Surah 3, 32. Allah does not love the unbelievers. I'm an unbeliever according to Islam, so Allah does not love me. Surah 3, 57. Allah does not love the unjust. Surah 4, 36. Allah does not love him who is proud or boastful. 7:31. Allah does not love the extravagant. 8:58. Allah does not love the treacherous. 28:77. Allah does not love mischief makers. 57:23. Allah does not love any arrogant boaster. Over and over and over again, we're given long lists of people that Allah just does not love. So if you believe in a God who doesn't love people very much, why is that sort of God going to enter into his creation to die for people's sins? Why would that sort of God come through the womb of a woman? That sort of God isn't going to do anything for us. But in Christianity, we believe in a God whose love is infinite. Would a God who loves us infinitely be willing to enter into his creation to pay the price for our sins? Of course. So the problem in Islam isn't just their low view of women, it's also their low view of God. I mean, think about it. According to Islam, I love people more than Allah. And let me break this down. If I'm better than your God in some way, then you're not believing in the one true God. Our God is superior to us in every possible way. Allah of the Quran is lower than most people in this world. His love is lower than most people in this world. So yes, Muslims have a problem with their theology and their view of women, of course.
Sister Magdalene, we actually had a few live shows a few months ago with a female Christian apologist, Mary Jo. She was in the studio. So if you are more interested to find out more information about women in Islam, make sure that you go to abnset.com. And if you click on the left-hand side to the online video section, you will locate those full-length live shows, and then you can find out more information on the topic of women in Islam. Right now, we will hang up the phone. Thank you for calling. Make sure that you call in later on in the show. I would like to get back to our topic of the evening. I know we've sort of been going off topic. A lot of good questions from the audience. Again, our topic tonight, Islam, Allah, and Jesus. And we'll go on to our next question. And it's this: if Allah is powerless to stop people from corrupting his message, can we even trust the Quran?
Going back to Surah 1064, which says, "They shall have good news in this world's life and the hereafter. There is no changing the words of Allah." You can't change Allah's words. But Allah revealed the Torah and the Gospel. The Torah and the Gospel were still around in his time. Why? Because Allah can protect them. But according to Islam, according to what Muslims tell us, the Bible's been corrupted. Why do they have to believe that? Because the Bible contradicts the teachings of Islam. So Muslims are forced, despite what the Quran says, no matter how many times the Quran affirms that the gospel is still around in Muhammad's time, Muslims have to believe that it was corrupted well before that. But here's the problem. If God revealed the Torah and it was corrupted, and God revealed the gospel and it was corrupted, then Allah isn't powerful enough to protect his message. Can we trust the Quran? Remember, you believe in a God now who can deliver a message, and he's just not powerful enough to stop it from being corrupted. Well, if you believe in a God who's not powerful enough to protect his message, how can you believe that the Quran has not been corrupted? What are you going to say? Are you going to say you know from history that the Quran has been perfectly preserved? No, you don't. I dare you. I dare you to call in and say that the Quran has been perfectly preserved, and I will take you to your most trusted sources, Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Sunan Abu Dawud, showing you from your own sources that your Quran has been corrupted. So theologically, if you believe in a God who can't protect his own message, you have no theological reason to trust that the Quran has been perfectly preserved. And historically, since we know historically that the Quran has been changed numerous times, you have no historical reason, no historical basis for saying that the Quran has been perfectly preserved. So if you're going to criticize the Bible, you need to throw out the Quran as well, my friends.
And just a few weeks ago, we did launch a 24-hour Christian apologetics webcast on our website. If you go to abnset.com, it's all in English, and it's based on your comments and your feedback, so make sure that you check that out. We're also in the process of launching an Arabic 24-hour Christian apologetics webcast, so stay tuned for that. Question number 7, David, that Muslims cannot seem to answer. Once the Christian heresy had started, why did Allah help the Christians rise to power?
Now, think about this. According to Islam, Jesus presented a message, and that message was Islam. Then Allah came along, corrupted the message by getting people to believe that Jesus died on the cross when he didn't. And someone else came along, the Apostle Paul, for instance, and he corrupted the message even further. So in the first century, the message is already corrupted by belief in Jesus' death, resurrection, and deity. But does Allah stop these heretical views? Does he correct them and make sure that the true followers of Jesus, that they become dominant? If you're a Muslim, you have to believe that the message was corrupted, and then Allah helped the message spread and become dominant. Remember, according to the Quran, Allah helped the followers of Jesus until they became uppermost over the Jews. Well, when did the followers of Jesus become more powerful than the Jews? When Christianity became dominant in the Roman Empire. But by that time, the message was Jesus died on the cross for sins, he rose from the dead, and he claimed to be divine. So the people that Allah helped, the people that Allah helped become dominant are the ones who are spreading this false heresy according to Islam. Allah didn't help the followers of Jesus who believed in Islam become powerful enough to take over the Roman Empire, no. He helped the followers of Jesus who are preaching a false, corrupt version of Christianity. Those are the ones he helped. So I would ask you, instead of helping the true followers of Jesus who are Muslims, according to you, instead of helping them, why did he help the Christians who believed in Jesus' deity, death, and resurrection? Why did he help them become dominant? Why? Why would he help people who are spreading false beliefs, shirk, and heresy? Why? What is your God thinking? I want to know.
And with that, our studio lines are open, 248-416-1300. We have over 30 full-length Jesus or Muhammad clips on our website. If you go to abnsat.com, go to the online video section, you can watch all the previous live shows on our website. Let's go to question 8. And Muslims, feel free to call us and interrupt at any time, because David would be very interested to be enlightened by your comments if you're able to do so. We're trying to reach the truth, but Muslims are somehow not able to do that on this show. Call us 248-416-1300. Question number 8, David. If Allah deceives people who follow his prophets, how do Muslims know that he isn't deceiving them? Your comment.
This is a very important question, because you Muslims believe in a God who deceives people, even deceives people who follow his prophets. Follow me now. According to Islam, Jesus won followers. Those followers agreed with Jesus, and they testified that there's only one God and that they are Muslims. So Jesus had Muslim followers. These Muslim followers of Jesus came to believe that he died on the cross. Where did they get the idea that he died on the cross? They got that idea from Allah, who tricked people into believing that Jesus died on the cross. So, even people who devoutly follow his prophets, even people who follow God's prophets, Allah will still trick them into believing false teachings. If you believe in a God who will trick and deceive even the people who follow his messengers, why do you believe that he's not tricking you? In other words, if you believe in a deceiver God who deceives people who follow his prophets, how do you know that he didn't send Muhammad as a false prophet who's going to deceive the Arabs? Why? I mean, think about this. You believe that Allah deceived the Jews. Why? Because he just doesn't like the Jews? Well, if you're going to say that, Allah deceived the Jews because he just doesn't like Jews. Well, think about this. The Arabs, they're rejecting the gospel. They're rejecting his message. If you believe in a God who deceives people for no real reason other than he just doesn't like them, how do you know Allah didn't like the Arabs and so he sends them a false prophet to keep them deceived? Once you have a God who deceives people for no reason, I don't know how you can trust anything, even the revelations that you think are from God.
And what we'll have to do, we'll take a quick break. We have about 30 minutes left on the show, so make sure that you call in these last 30 minutes. If you don't get through, or if you'd like, join us at 9:45 tonight. David, Pastor Joseph, and Waleed Shubat will be live in the studio. Also, there's another special live show at midnight tonight. It will be in Arabic, and that will be with Waleed Shubat and Dr. Bassem, so make sure that you stay tuned for that. We will take a quick break. We'll be right back. You're watching Jesus or Muhammad on ABN.
Light of men.
Defender of widows.
Ruler.
Holy.
All-knowing.
My song.